photo taken by an Oak Lawn man. This shows a greenish-white mist, which was not visible to the naked eye, and yet which was out there when Tony snapped the shot.
Mm-hmm.
Tony's been able to duplicate this many times, as have many other people. And any high school students out there looking for science fair project, psychic photography, way to go for the future, try it at Bachelor's Grove. With Polaroid color film, you've got a pretty good chance of maybe duplicating that or getting even
better
shots.
Now, was that taken during the daytime?
That was taken towards sundown.
Towards sundown?
Towards sundown.
So in available light.
Available light.
That's a picture of a bluish-white something.
Something
that we don't know what it is.
Not visible to the naked eye, but which was caught on film.
What is it? Do we know?
You want to
do
call it a ghost? The closest thing to a ghost that we have on good photographic evidence around Chicago.
But what was in Bachelor's Grove? Why is it called Bachelor's Grove? Possible ghost was it?
It's a great name, and it stems from the time when the first settlers arrived in that area.
Mm-hmm.
That's Bremen Township. The settlers were German immigrants from the seaport of Bremen, and they were bachelors.
Mm-hmm.
When they came to live here and set up truck farms back in the 1830s and 40s, they were bachelors. Eventually, they sent back to Germany for their girlfriends and sweethearts and
mm-hmm.
raised families. But the name did stick, Bachelor's Grove. And why is it haunted? Nobody seems to know why, but over the years, there have been reports of a disappearing house, disappearing cars, a blue ghost light, a disappearing house. And now, the latest photographic evidence of something weird out there.
All right. Now, the next slide concerns the St. Valentine's Day Massacre, and this, I take it, is the present site.
That's what it looks like today.
Today.
2122 North Clark Street. The garage was torn down in 1967 to make mm-hmm. room for a housing project for the elderly.
Okay, now I asked you specifically about this and other sites. Chicago is infamous, unfortunately so, for sites of many murders. With everything torn down, is anything ever cited there? I mean, Clark Street is right near Fullerton. It's
right,
in the middle of town. You know?
The fact that the building is torn down is the reason we're having things reported these days, because when the building was in use, the owners wouldn't let people in. It was
mm-hmm.
closed up at night. Nobody was around.
Yeah.
And now you can actually go and stand right on the spot where the massacre took place. And from 67, when the building came down, a number of reports began to circulate in the area. People saying that they had heard sobbing and moaning sounds and things of that sort at night.
Really?
But of course, if it's somebody who knew what happened, they could imagine perhaps what's going on.
Yeah.
But besides that, we've got animals acting up. People walking their dogs. The dogs stare, growl, look ahead,
see
something.
The hair goes up on
exactly,
the dog?
Exactly. Including, on one occasion, a canine German Shepherd from the police department.
Did what? Just
acted
freaked out?
Freaked
over
out,
there?
Stared, growled, pulled away. And if the policeman who had him hadn't
mm-hmm.
told me, he said, he knows the dog like his wife and kids. I mean,
yeah.
He's with the dog more than his wife and kids. He gave the dog the benefit of the doubt because of the history of that site.
Of course, I know some people who live in that neighborhood, and when they get their rent bills each month, they moan and groan too. So it might be that might be the sound of it. Now, we're going to go to the most famous ghost area and place in Chicago. Many, many sightings. A song written about it. This is Resurrection Cemetery, and we have a slide of it now. This is what? What am I seeing here?
Well, we could talk about apparitions of Resurrection Mary and sightings of the girl going back close to 50 years now. But there's a physical evidence side to the existence of that beautiful blonde ghost around Resurrection Cemetery. In August of 1976, a sergeant from the Justice Police Department discovered two of the bars on the front gate bent apart. And this was discovered at night. He was on patrol. There had been a call that someone had seen a girl in white, a blonde, walking through the cemetery. He went there to check out on this report, found the bars bent, but what really frightened him was a close examination of the bars showed that there was actual handprints squeezed into the bronze. Now, these are bronze bars about 1/16 of an inch thick.
Oh, here's a picture.
That's a close-up. The bronze bars are 1/16 of an inch thick, and yet somehow some person or thing with incredible strength, much above and beyond physical human strength, could bend the bars apart, squeeze the impressions of hands in. I think you can see very easily where the thumb, ball of thumb, and knuckle of thumb can fit right into the side of that bar.
Mm-hmm.
And while that was taking place, at the same time, the bars were scorched. So the hands that did this were able to exude an incredible amount of heat
mm-hmm.
while doing this.
Now,
certainly
is that
nothing
gate
human
there now? Can you see that?
Unfortunately, the cemetery didn't share my enthusiasm.
Uh-huh.
This was discovered in August of 76. In spring of 77, they blowtorched the bars in an attempt to destroy the marks. Blowtorching only succeeded in blackening the bars and attracting much more attention. And
mm-hmm.
if the number of cars was large before, 2 to 3 times as many people began to stop by when they were blowtorched. So eventually they were sawed out, disappeared mm-hmm. in the fall of 1977, were sent away to a mill, and only came back again in December of 1978, at which time they had been totally altered and changed, and the
wow.
handprints done away with. So only the photographic evidence exists today.
All right, let's take a moment. Where is Resurrection Cemetery, and what happens? What is a typical sighting? Because there have been so many of them over the years. Tell me the story.
Resurrection Cemetery is at 7200 South Archer in Justice, Illinois, right along Archer. In fact, some people take the whole area, calling it the Resurrection Triangle, Archer to Roberts to 79th Street, a huge isosceles triangle, most of which is occupied by Resurrection Cemetery. And over the years, there have been many sightings of a blonde in a white dress walking along the cemetery fence, across the street from the cemetery, or even in and out through the closed gates. And of course, that can't be a hoaxer, because you can't walk in and out through closed gates if you're solid matter. And yet, that's how that girl has been seen. She's been seen this year on three occasions that I've been able to check on.
This year, 1983.
1983, and the most recent occasion was in the month of June by a girl who's dating an IRS agent I know, and she saw the girl along the side of the road and just panicked and hit the gas and took off. And invariably, the girl is gone by the time you're up to her or pass her. She disappears.
All right, aren't there people who give her rides?
Right. Okay. The story of the girl being met at a dance, perhaps, being met somewhere along the road and given a lift, only to disappear in the car itself, or later to ask to be let off. Always around the front side of the cemetery, around the front gates. This has been going back as far as 1939. Mm-hmm. A Southwest Side man that I know had this happen to him in that year, but it also has happened in January of 1979 to a cab driver, and twice in August of 1980 to young men on the Southwest Side.
All right, now, who was Resurrection Mary? Do we know? I mean, is there a grave from where she comes or something like that?
Well, that's a very hotly debated topic out of the southwestern area. Resurrection Mary is almost like a generic term for the blonde in the white dress who comes out and haunts. I think there's probably two to three ghosts involved. One young lady, though, that was described by earlier caretakers from Resurrection Cemetery as the Resurrection Mary, was a girl who died in 1934 when her head went through the windshield of a car during an automobile accident. She was coming home from a party in her party dress, and apparently she could well be one of the Resurrection Marys. I really think that there's more than one.
We're going to have a lot more ghost stories. I want people to stay tuned, because we're going to have pictures and places and ghost stories for you from Chicago, from Richard T. Crowe, after this.
Each weekday at 10, Channel 32 has a great morning in store. It starts with Breakaway, an hour of everything from timely features to comedy to investigative reporting. Then at 11, it's me, Gary Collins, with my show, Our Magazine. You'll find our 60 minutes filled with entertainment plus useful information on such things as medicine and how to overcome emotional and psychological problems. Chicago, make your mornings mean more. Each weekday at 10, here on Channel 32.
Some races are for fun. But every day there's another kind of race, to save lives. Hi, I'm Andy Williams. More than 30,000 pints of blood are needed daily. And any one of these youngsters, or yours, could require blood urgently. Donate blood now. Don't wait till we run out of time. Blood is life. Keep it running. Someone you love may need it in a hurry.
Continues now with your host, Norman Mark.
My guest today is a gentleman who spends a lot of time researching ghosts right here in the Chicagoland area. He also does it in the Midwest, but mainly in the Chicagoland area. His name, Richard T. Crowe, ghost hunter. And if you wish to take a tour with Mr. Richard T. Crowe, you would phone 735-2530, 735-2530. And please call during the week, because on the weekend he doesn't
want
to phone.
He's on the road
hunting ghosts. All right, now, have we finished all the stories about Resurrection Mary?
Actually, I could go on for probably about a half an hour.
Is she a harmful ghost? Does she ever hurt anybody or anything?
Not at all, Norman. In fact, in collecting ghost stories for years now, 10 years professionally, running tours, and going back a number of years before that, I've never found, to paraphrase Will Rogers, a ghost I didn't like.
All right, now,
they're always
but,
nice.
But with these guys that give a ride to her or see her or something like that, if they're in the car, I mean, can you feel her? I mean, is she there, or do you just kind of go right through? I mean,
okay.
Well, what is the feeling of giving a ghost ride in your Pontiac or something?
That's a very interesting question. Now, we have different categories of ghostly occurrences.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes the ghost appears to be as solid as anyone living, and yet they can, in a split second, disappear. Then there are, of course, the traditional ghosts that are semi-transparent. You get close, you see that you can see through them.
Oh, those blue-green things that we
right.
saw in the picture.
Also, there are categories of things that are not visual at all. Sometimes smelling a psychic scent, like the scent of violets from mm-hmm. the Robinson Woods. Sometimes just hearing voices. Sometimes feeling a cold spot, which is said to be maybe mm-hmm. step one on the way up to being materialization.
Do you ever feel like there's someone behind you? Or
that's right. The feeling of people around you, things around
or?
You. The feeling of being pushed in on by things which are not there, but you can definitely feel. Those sorts of things are certainly within the uh-huh. generic term of ghosts.
All right, we have a slide from another sighting, a place where there was a sighting this year, and that's the Country House, I understand. I think that's the Country
House. Right, the Country House restaurant, a very popular little restaurant on 55th Street in Clarendon Hills, just west of Route 83. Actually, not a sighting this year, but many experiences this year, as in
what, patrons
more recent
sitting
years,
there having a hamburger have ghosts come in?
Well, they have, the ghost is there. The ghost doesn't come in, but the ghost is already there. Footsteps on the top floor, footsteps coming down from the stairwell, and probably one of the more interesting evenings was the night a patron was leaving, turned to look at the restaurant for some reason, and in the window, above the doorway there,
that window, above
the
door,
uh-huh,
the
saw a beautiful blonde looking out. You know, blondes make good ghosts. They're always around. He sees a beautiful blonde, so he goes back in the restaurant, and he says to David Regnery, one of the owners, he says, "Well, David, I see you're lucky tonight. You've got a blonde upstairs waiting." David blustered and said, "No, I don't have any blonde upstairs," but of course he ran right upstairs to check
uh-huh.
and went from room to room, no blonde. But apparently she is the ghost caused after a woman had left the place in a huff about 30 years ago mm-hmm. after not getting the attention of a bartender she wanted and crashed in a utility pole, and she's been coming back ever since.
Coming back, what, for better service?
Coming
probably.
Back, coming maybe back looking for another bartender.
Because the waitress didn't serve her.
Right, right.
Now, with these ghosts in this restaurant, I mean, I can't imagine in a commercial establishment there's ghosts. I mean, do they ever come up to the patrons and kind of, you know, say, "Hey, I'm a ghost"? While you're eating there, you hear these sounds?
These ghosts are usually heard towards closing time and maybe quieter times. Because
uh-huh.
with a restaurant, actually, or with any establishment that's mm-hmm. busy and noisy, and I'm sure there are plenty of ghosts around, maybe around us now, but so much other activity.
In this station?
Well, quite possibly.
Oh, ghosts of old station managers.
Theoretically,
lots of them. Yes.
Theoretically, they're around, but you know, unless you've got the time to calm down a bit and take it in, you often walk right by.
Does anybody spend the night in the Country House restaurant and have ghosts bother them in their sleep or something like that?
Well, there have been people. In fact, there's one room upstairs that is let out on occasion, and among the people who've used that room are mostly people who've had experiences uh-huh. who do know about the ghosts.
All right. The next picture, I understand, is something called the Hungry Fence.
The Hungry Fence, right. Now, I can't claim fame to inventing that term. Terry McEldowney, a well-known Southwest Side singer, mm-hmm. invented the term a few years ago after it was noticed that as cars drive by 111th Street at night between Western and Kedzie in the Mount Greenwood area,
uh-huh.
that for some reason they very often veer and smash into this fence. So the fence is literally hungry for passing cars or vans or trucks, what have you.
No, wait a minute. Cars going by here, it's 111th in the Mount Greenwood area on
right.
the Southwest Side
mm-hmm.
in Chicago.
That's correct.
That fence eats cars.
It gobbles them up as they go by.
Okay.
And it sounds very sounds very diabolical. It sounds very supernatural. And yet, there is probably a very basic and very natural explanation for it. You see, there are certain forms of epilepsy that can be triggered by flashing lights.
Mm-hmm.
And a strobe light flashing at 7 lights per second can induce in people who are prone to it a epileptic seizure uh-huh. or trance-like state. Now, because of the vertical bars in the cemetery fence, if you're driving by at sundown, for instance, and the rays of the setting sun are flashing through those bars, mm-hmm. and they're broken up by the bars, or if you're driving by and the headlights of your car are reflecting off the polished fronts of tombstones, if your speed is such, and your position of the lights on mm-hmm. stones are such, and you're watching this,
yeah.
and you get this 7 flashes of light per second a frequency, if you're prone towards that sort of epilepsy, all of a sudden you're dozing off into a trance-like state, you turn the wheels of your car towards the light, next thing you know, you smashed into the fence.
All right, so what we have is a ghost hunter that has an explanation.
This is a
non-ghost,
a very rational explanation for what at first glance appears to be a totally supernatural incident.
Okay, now the next slide is a reference to the murder castle, I understand.
Mm-hmm.
And the murder castle is, this is not the murder castle.
This is what now stands on the site. Now, Murder Castle, of course, is one of your favorite places to talk about. Eddie Schwartz talks about this all the time at WGN. It's a very popular spot because it is indeed a very historic location if you get into morbid history. It's there that Dr. Holmes had his infamous murder castle, in which he did away with many young ladies.
Okay,
who he would.
This is at 63rd and what?
611 West 63rd Street. It's the Inglewood Post Office today.
Okay, now, what I wanted to find out, once again, with all the famous, you know, the Dr. Holmes, at one time in the Guinness Book of Records, I think, held the record for probably the man who murdered the most people ever. Most people these days don't know about him, but he set up a human body factory during the 1893 Columbian Exposition and was just killing off people, perhaps by the scores, maybe more than 100, and for 30, 40 years afterward, they were finding bodies and parts of bodies all over the country. He had business cards printed up, you know, honest dealer in human parts or something like that. I mean, he was a ghoul, a true one. And they've torn his murder castle down and built a U.S. post office on it. And I asked you, okay, in that post office, is there ever any ghostly sightings?
Well, I don't know of a sighting, but it is curious that you brought that up because a few years ago I received a letter from a woman who said, as a girl growing up in that area, she didn't know why, but she could never walk on that side of the street. She always had this just horrible, uncanny feeling and chills up her spine when she was trying to walk by that particular building. And only years later did she eventually find out what had stood there, the infamous murder castle.
So there was, like, step one, a feeling
That's right.
going on.
Apparently she was able to psychically tune in to the tragedy that had taken place there, the tragedies that had taken place there.
All right. Do you have any explanation about what causes ghosts or, you know, any theory about them? You told me before the show that it was something about sex and ghosts. I don't know about it.
Many people have tied in sexual energy and life energy with the idea of ghosts, and, of course, many former brothels are haunted. The country house years ago was used as a house of prostitution.
Was that why there's the blonde in the window?
Well, she dates from after that. But there is a possibility that maybe some of the other footsteps are not hers, but it might have sort of fueled up the fire there at that spot to make it appropriate for such things. There are many interesting tie-ins between running water and ghosts, for instance. The old idea that ghosts can't cross running water. We have many haunted sites near the Des Plaines River, and they're always on the east side. They're never on the west side near the Des Plaines. So the idea that ghosts are near running water but don't cross apparently has some validity. And is that because of the electromagnetic field around running water, water in motion? Is this fueling the ghost? I really think there's a strong tie between the natural and what we call the supernatural. It's really not supernatural. It's just we haven't come to grips with it yet. We don't understand it or how it works or how it functions.
Why is it that Chicago has a reputation for having lots of gangsters and lots of murderers and murder castles and everything like that, but doesn't necessarily have a reputation of being a ghostly center or something like that? You think of perhaps London, certainly, as the ghost capital of the world. But you found any number of stories about our town, about ghosts.
And times are really changing, Norman. In August, I had a film crew in town from Yorkshire Television in England. So now we have England coming to Chicago to study our ghosts. And I think that's a great tribute that can be paid. When England comes to study our ghosts, we must have something to offer.
Is it, do you find it that Chicagoans are more skeptical, that you have to believe in ghosts to see them sort of thing?
I think it's an idea that it's always a prophet in his own country isn't really accepted. When we have a ghost and we have a supernatural tale in our own backyard, we don't really accept it perhaps as we should. We go looking for ghosts in faraway and exotic lands. We go to London or Egypt or Loch Ness or whatever, looking for mysteries. But there are mysteries right here in our own backyard.
All right, let's just take a moment to go back, because we went over some of the stuff. I pushed you through it really quite quickly. Pick a sighting from Robinson Woods, Bachelor's Grove, Resurrection Cemetery, Country House, whatever, and one of the witnesses, and tell me about it, and tell me what he or she felt and what they experienced.
Would you like me to tell you something that I had happen to me?
Sure.
Well, at Bachelor's Grove in 1977, it was a May night. I was driving out to the area to visit it with a friend who was in town from Colorado.
Okay, now where is this again?
That's 143rd Street, just east of Ridgeland.
Okay.
We were out in the area looking around the cemetery, and found absolutely nothing except hordes of mosquitoes. Mm-hmm. So decided to leave. We got in the car. We're driving west down 143rd Street.
Okay.
Crossed over a creek of running water, the running water once again, and there on the right was a parked car, all dark. And as I passed it, I was the driver, I just swerved a little bit to the left to go around it, maybe a few feet out of my way, so that in case somebody wouldn't open a door from the car, that was the only thing I was worried about. And as I passed it, bam, the car was gone.
The entire car disappeared?
The entire car had disappeared.
I want to find out more ghost stories. We'll finish that one.
Okay.
After we take this break.
Imagine a romantic, luxurious vacation skimming over sun-drenched seas. Now the American Express Vacation Store, one of the world's largest travel companies, can give you the holiday of your dreams on one of the fabulous fun ships of the Carnival Cruise Lines. Come aboard and experience a lavish vacation on a magnificent floating resort where every day is a holiday, every night a celebration, where you can enjoy unlimited activities or just sit back and soak up the sun. Right now, through the American Express Vacation Store, you can spend 7 glorious days cruising the Caribbean for an unbelievably low price, and your airfare is free to and from your port of departure. So why take a chance when you take a vacation? Visit the American Express Vacation Store and let our travel experts set you sailing on a Carnival cruise, a vacation you'll treasure forever.
For the American Express Vacation Store nearest you, see the ad in the travel section of Sunday's Chicago Sun-Times. Or look in the yellow pages under travel agencies.
Chicago 83 continues now with your host, Norman Mark.
We are talking about actual ghost stories right here in the Chicagoland area with Richard T. Crowe. He is a ghost hunter. He organizes tours of ghostly places. And if you wish a ghost tour, you would call him at 735-2530, and please do that during the week, because on the weekend he's out looking. All right, we're in the middle of a story, and I had a break for the break.
Mm-hmm.
You went up to the car, and the whole car...
The entire car suddenly was not there within 6-7 feet of me.
Okay.
So I instantly hit the brakes, stopped the car in the middle of the road, and looked at my watch to see what time it was, 2:10. And I started yelling to my friend, Jim Brandon, who was there with me, who is the author of a book called Weird America, and who wanted specifically to see Bachelor's Grove to look for ghosts. And believe it or not, he hadn't seen a thing because he was facing me talking all the time. And I tried to explain to him what I had just seen, and to make matters worse, he really didn't want to believe it. He tried to make various rationalizations for how it could have disappeared, how I could have been wrong, how it could have been a car I saw in the rearview mirror, and just through lazy mental process had thought to be at the side of the road or so on. And I said, no, I did see it. And it bothered me so very, very much. Well, of course, that's a very strange type of encounter to come upon, a disappearing car. Yeah. And to top it off, to have a witness but someone who wasn't observant, who hadn't seen it. So I was overjoyed when in September of 1978, over a year later, I had something similar happen to me again, very nearby, another disappearing car. And on that night, just about 11:30, driving down towards the cemetery area, which is something I just do anyway to keep tabs on it, to keep an eye on it, I saw a car in motion this time, backing across the road, and its lights went off, and I presumed it was just a squad car pulling into the Rubio Woods Forest Preserve entrance to hide and set up radar and monitor the area. And as I got up to that site within seconds, no car in the driveway. And of course, instead of being fearful at this point, I was overjoyed that I was vindicated. I had seen it twice, and there are indeed disappearing cars.
Were there other sightings since then?
Oh, yes, there have been. I had heard about it before. But you always wonder about that. You always wonder about your witnesses and how totally... upstanding and straight they are. Until you have the experience yourself, you always have a little nagging doubt about the witnesses.
Well, I tell you, what's fascinating to me is you are, you know, very solid and real, and you're talking about the unreal, and I think convincing me a little bit. You know, it's all right if I'm skeptical yet.
Fine,
it's okay.
It's the best attitude to have if you're a healthy, open-minded skeptic.
Mm-hmm.
What I don't like are the closed-minded people who masquerade as skeptics, and yet when they do find, I feel, overwhelming evidence, still won't say yes, there's something to it.
Anybody ever go on your tour and then say, come back to you a year or two later and just was freaked out by what they saw? Just absolutely, my gosh, I really
saw it. Probably would be the night we first saw the Maple Lake ghost light, and this was going back now about 4 years, Halloween weekend. And I had heard stories about a red ball of light on the other side of Maple Lake on 95th Street, east of Archer, for years. And I had collected these stories and always had a little bit of doubt.
I tell you what we will do is leave that ghost story just kind of hanging in the ether of television. Okay, the Maple Lake ghost light. We'll have to have you back for another ghost story. His name, Richard T. Crowe. I'm Norman Mark. Ghost stories for you from our area. Thank you.
Monday night at 10:30, Dick Cavett, Bubba Smith, and Rick Nelson join Alan on Thick of the Night. Be sure to join us. Now stay tuned for our people, Los Hispanos, with host Carmelo Melendez, next on Channel 32. Weeknights at 6, join the crew of the Sunshine Cab Company as they drive comedy to a new high on Taxi. We've got the...